Good morning. On this beautiful Sunday morning after a pirate victory. Yeah, go Pirates, yeah. I'm sorry I didn't hear that, so I cannot repeat that, but thank you. And all the teams that were victorious and those who played hard yesterday. I will leave that there. So welcome to Winterville Christian Church, where all belong. We have a couple of announcements this morning. We have on October 2nd, it's World Bread Day, World Communion Day. We ask that you consider bringing in different breads from various countries. So World Communion Day is on October the 2nd. On October the 16th, it is Winterville Christian Church's homecoming. There will be a special service and a meal in the fellowship hall shortly thereafter. And after church today, there's some coffee and a few light refreshments if you would like to have some fellowship after church today in the fellowship hall. And Abbott, did you want to share? Thank you, Abbott. We'd like to welcome back Reverend Satella Long and his wife, Dee. He brings a lot of experience, and the way he delivers a message is so powerful with graciousness and his gift of voice and song. We have another announcement. Yes, Anel. Thank you, Anel. So welcome back to those familiar faces. Welcome to the new folks. And another quick announcement. We have our youngest church member with us today. I think Hart Beckham Hudson is in the house today. So welcome, Hart. Aaron, did you have an announcement? Okay. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Aaron Lucier, our board moderator for Winterville Christian Church for the guests in the room. Glad to be back. We just got back from a little trip. I did want to speak really briefly. Julia and the worship team has done a great job, and our minister has done a great job of talking about stewardship this month, and it has been a focus this month. So I wanted to highlight a few things in relationship to the church in terms of stewardship. So several people have come forward in their willingness to be on the nominating committee. And at our next board meeting, which is next Sunday after the services, so for the board members in the room, we are going to meet after services next week. So pack a lunch, bring a lunch, run out and get a quick lunch, but we're going to be meeting. We are going to vote on that nominating committee. And then that nominating committee, it's going to go about its work. And that work is finding people to be in leadership positions in this church. And so as we talk about stewardship, which is also the gifts of talent and time and effort, I would ask that if somebody is from that nominating committee calls you, that you feel and you discern that call from that nominating committee, that there may be God talking to you about your ability to be a leader in this church. And that's a really part, a big part of what we need. A small church means a lot of work to be done by hopefully a good collection of hands. And we're excited that we have a lot of new faces in the room, and we continue to have new faces in the room, but we're asking that maybe you think about how you can be involved in this church in that special way. The other part of stewardship that we don't talk about probably enough in this church is giving. We know we give a lot of our time and effort and all that other stuff, but it also does sometimes mean that we need to give from our wallets. And as we look at our nominated committee, that's also the season we start looking towards our budget in November, October. So fall is nominating season and fall is budget season. And so as you reflect on how you give or the ways that you give, consider how we give to this church. Your gifts make the rest of the work possible. We are very fortunate that we are a church that has an endowment. We are a church that doesn't have a lot of debt, but that would change if we don't continue to give, and we need to remember that. And so as you reflect each Sunday, think about how you can give to this church, either in time, effort, energy, prayers, whatever which way, but reflect upon that and think about how you could be a good steward of God's church here in Winterville, North Carolina. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Aaron. And because all are welcome here, yes, we even welcome those Wolfpack fans. So congratulations on your win. At this time, we'll have Colton bring in the light of Christ. Thank you, Colton. At this time, if you'll turn to page 694 in your chalice hymnal for our call to worship, Caring for the Earth, I will lead the regular part, and the heavy, bold part will be for the congregation to share. 694. Caring for Earth. We have faith
in one God, one source of all rights, one ground of the whole earth.
And thus we believe
in the goodness of earth's life, in the innate worth of all its dependence, in human partnership,
in the life of nature. And thus we believe
that in Christ we have been shown the special role of the human race to bear God's likeness in working and caring for the earth. In seeking to understand its mysteries and powers, in gently working with these powers for the well-being of all children of the earth.
And thus we believe
that God's Spirit will lead us to sensitive closeness with earth's life,
to the meek, unselfish, and compassionate lifestyle by which the earth is inherited in peace.
By which its life is transformed for all creatures to share justly in its bounty.
So be it. Amen. Thank you. And now if you'll join us in our opening hymn, it'll be on the screen behind me. All those of old their first fruits brought. Far screen, not to be confused with Forrest Gump.
As those of old were
Thank you. Well done. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, as we forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you. It looks like it is time for the offertory. Thank you. You may be seated.
Blessings flow, praise God, all creatures here below. God, we take time to dedicate these offerings to you. We thank you for blessing us to be able to give. We thank you for the many ways that you're going to manifest your glory in blessing others through these gifts. We give thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. And now, it looks like we're going to have the passing of the peace to a tune very familiar to all of us. We had Ray Stevens earlier, and now we've got Carole King. You got a friend.
Hey, nice to meet you, Matt.
Okay.
Good to see you.
Good to see you, darling.
Spot
That's
with
okay.
that. Thank you.
That's all right.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you.
And you know wherever I am, I'll come running to see you again. When winter? Winter, spring, summer, or fall, all you got to do is call, and I'll be there. Yes, I will. You got a friend. That was wonderful. Thank you, Mitzi, for leading us in that, and thank you for joining in.
Reverend Long.
Yes.
I forgot the joys and concerns of the congregation. Might we have any joys to share? We have a baby. Hart Beckham's in the house. Yes.
We just wanted to reach out to everybody who's reached out to us, who's seen him, who joined in on that meal train. We didn't realize like what a blessing that would be. So thank you all for helping us out during this time. So we really appreciate it.
You are quite welcome.
The prayer concerns for Mary Forlines. Mary is still in the hospital, recovering from her pacemaker battery surgery with the infection. Do we have an update?
Go visit her. She's in the Heart Center. She's in room 607. She's doing, you know, she's feeling great. She just has to be here for the, you know,
infection. Okay.
Right. So go see her. She's loved that.
Wonderful. Thank you. Anel. Wonderful. Thank you. We want to be mindful and keep these people in our thoughts and prayers. We'd also like to remember the family of Jean Raymond McCreary. That's Penny's father who passed recently. And Leo Scott, a friend of Greg's who passed suddenly. We'd like to keep them all in our thoughts and prayers this week. Yes. From Aiden Middle School football. Would that be number 11? Yes, we want to keep him in our thoughts and prayers as well. Anyone else have any prayer concerns or joys to share? Yes. We will keep them in our prayers as well. For those that travel. I know. Yes, Jane. It's a joy to certainly see you again. It's been a while. I hear you've been traveling. Aaron.
And it's a joy to be home as well. Our trip went really well, and it was a really great experience. And my sister remains on the prayer list, and I continue to ask that you continue to pray for her. She's still struggling, so thank you.
Thank you, Aaron. We will indeed do that as well. Aaron and Cliff were in Paris representing Pirates in Paris. I saw the photos from there, too. So thank you all for sharing joys and concerns. We will definitely keep those people in our prayers. Thank you, Reverend Long.
Thank you for using your gift. Let us pray. Dear God, we pause and center ourselves on you. We thank you for the prayers and concerns that were lifted up, the joys. We give thanks for those, the concerns. We give thanks for those. We thank you for hearing our heartfelt prayers, Lord God, and answering them by your grace and mercy. We consecrate this time to you and ask that you meet us at the point of our need. We ask that you illuminate our hearts and our minds to receive from you today. We ask right now that you speak, Lord God, and be a very present help in time of need. We thank you that you're present in our midst. You're always here, Lord God, but we thank you for your word that allows us to understand that we can have confidence in your being very present with us. Because your word tells us where two or three are gathered together in your name, you're there. So we thank you, Lord God, for having confidence in that. Now we dedicate this time to you, in Jesus' name, amen. Our scripture reading for today comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. And it reads as follows, and I may read a couple of passages. So if you've got your Bibles or if it's up on the screen, that's fine too. Yeah, I like that too. And it reads as follows. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you, always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. And another version reads as follows. I like reading different versions so we can all get a caption of what is being said here, because God's word is very important. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, so that having all sufficiency, everybody say all, in all things, at all times, you may abound in every good work. To read it in context, basically, you understand that the Apostle Paul was writing to the Corinthian church. He was writing to believers, and we are believers as well, so we can translate that as to speaking to us as well. And Paul was challenging folks to make sure they come with a heart and attitude, like I said on last Sunday, where you have a cheerfulness in mind. Because God loves, as we said last week, a cheerful giver. Amen? And a cheerful giver is one who's prepared, already got it down pat, that they know exactly how they're going to make sure that they do right by God. Not that God needs it, but God just desires to be a blessing to you. See, the God I serve has everything, is everything, and has made everything. God is able. That's the name of our text today. God is able. And what do we mean by that? Well, basically, God is basically almighty. Almighty, loving, bold, and is everywhere. The God I serve is an almighty God. God has all power in his hands. You know this. It's real easy to talk about God. And God, one of the main things about God, that God decided to make a big difference in your life and my life, because the God I serve is a bold God. What do I mean by that? Well, this almighty God decided to make a bold declaration that I'm going to share some of me with you. Why? Because you're made in my image. When God made you, and God made you, and God made me, God said, look, I love you too much to leave you the way you are, so I'm going to make sure I make a bold decision about how I'm going to share a little bit of me with you. How did he do that? Well, down through the eons of time, God made this quiet decision to say, look, my people can't live life all alone. I'm going to make sure that I give them some help. And down through the eons of time, he gave us the greatest help of all. He gave us his son, Jesus the Christ. And see, Jesus Christ lived the life that we could not live. He died the death that we could not die. And he is on the right hand of God right now making intercession for little old me and little old you, saying, I hope they understand what this text means. God is able to make all grace abound toward you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. That's a bold statement. That's bold. He's given all that to you and me. See, the catch is this. It's not for just anybody. It's for those who choose to make sure that they, number one, claim God by saying yes to accepting Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And two, those who make a decision to believe God. You know, because the Bible says without faith, it is impossible. Okay? Without faith, it is impossible to believe God. And God has given us that little bit of faith, because the Bible says to every man has been given, or every woman has been given, the measure of faith. So we've got that measure that God says, look, I'm going to give you a little bit of me, but I'm going to give a little bit of me in a measure. And in that measure, it's up to you how you make it grow. If you use it diligently, it will grow and you will develop. If you don't use it diligently, guess what? It'll just be there until you decide to use it, but it will just wither away. You see, the difference between capable and able is this. Able is if someone or something is able to do something, they have the skills or qualities to make it possible to do it. Capable is if a person or thing is capable of doing something. They have the ability and capacity and potential to do it, but they, you know, have to develop to be able to get it done. The God I serve is an able God. He's able to do what he said he can do. And I trust him to be able to do it, don't you? And the God I serve, you know, I like the fact that God is a loving God. He loves you and he loves me unconditionally. That means whatever mistake, whatever misstep you've made, God says, there's nothing you can do to stop my love from reaching out to you. Absolutely nothing. As long as you have made that decision to say, I believe in you, God. I trust you, God. Do you make mistakes after you accept God? Yeah, look in the mirror. We all make mistakes. Ain't that right, honey? For those who are listening over the airwaves and over Facebook, I looked at my wife when I said that. So, yeah, we make mistakes. But the God I serve is a God who, in spite of our frailties, in spite of our faults, says, yes, I'm still going to pick you up. I'm still going to love you just the way you are. Come on, we can do this thing together. I heard Aaron say that we need to make sure we're generous in our time and in our gifts, but also in our giving. The Macedonian church did it right in that the Macedonian church decided to do the first thing. The first thing was to give themselves. Give yourself to God. And as you give yourself to God, everything else is going to come with it. Once we give ourselves to God, we allow God to be able to do what God said he's going to do. God is able to make all things abound in us so that having all sufficiency, I mean everything that you need in all things, at all times, you may abound in not some but every good work. Did I go off screen? That's okay. I can't help that. But the big thing about the God I serve is the fact that not only is God almighty, not only is the fact that God is a bold God, not only is the fact that God loves us unconditionally, but see, the reason God can be so bold about it is because there's nowhere we can go that God ain't there. Okay, teachers who like to speak proper English, there's nowhere God can go that he is not there. God is everywhere. That's the omniscience of God. The God you serve, even though you might try to hide from God, God still sees. I remember the time when I was a youngster and I thought I'd made a big mistake and I said, I can get away with it. God can't see me. God knew about it the whole time. God knows every little thing that we do. So I don't know why you try to fake like God don't know when God does know. See, the God I serve is a God who sees the foibles that we make and still says, look, get your act together. I already know that you messed up, so fess up and I'll forgive you. The Bible puts it this way. If you confess your sins, God is faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. That's there. It's in the book. So don't try to hide from God when we mess up. Go ahead and just let God clean you up. Now, God does all this because he knows he's got a greater plan in your life. See, God has a great purpose for each and every one of us. No matter how young you are, whether you're still suckling on mom, or no matter how old you are, whether you're sitting over there like Mary Fourlines looking at us from ECU Health Medical Center, room 607, and Mary, I know you're listening because you already told me you're going to be checking us out. God has a plan for you, and God is able to make it manifest in your life. All you got to do is do your part. What's my part? Let me make it real simple. All you got to do is be a sower. Everybody say sower.
Sower.
Sower of your time, your talent, or your treasure. Because God gives you the seed to sow. It's right there in the book. You can read it for yourself further down. God gives you the seed to sow. And as he gives you the seed, he tells you the purpose for it. It's to sow. Guess what? God doesn't tell you how to sow. He says, sow it. So you have the free will to make up your mind how you're going to be a blessing so that God can get the glory. You don't sow so that you can just say, look what I did. Look what I gave. Look what I did. Look what I shared. No. You sow so that you're in obedience to what God has called you to do, and you be sure to give God the glory. And watch God make a way out of no way for you. I'm reminded of a little child who was pleased to walk along with her daddy. And she would walk beside daddy in this park, and as she was walking beside daddy in the park, she would just walk around. She would go grab daddy's hand, and she'd just try to hang on to daddy's hand, and then she'd come to a little pothole or something like that, and she'd stumble and fall. And then dad would go down there and pick her up, and then she'd start walking again, having a wonderful time walking in the park. And she fell and stumbled a second time. And daddy went back and picked her up again so that she could walk alongside daddy again. And then she fell a third time as they were walking along the way. And this time the little girl said, "Daddy, won't you take my hand?" And so daddy took her hand. And as he did, they started walking again. But this time as she came through these little potholes or whatever, daddy just held her up and kept her steady as she walked along the way. So what's the point of this? Well, you know, our God is able. We got to put ourselves in God's hand and allow God to hold us, casting all our care upon him because he cares for us. If you let God handle it, I think he can, don't you? So the God I serve is well able to make all grace abound toward you, so that having all sufficiency in all things, at all times, you may abound in every good work. That's the God that I serve. I love it because God has made this so plain and made it so real in my life. You know, I was one who, a long time ago, made my mistakes. I fell flat on my face, but God looked down and saw me and said, "Look, son, I'm able." God will do what he said he would do. I'm not perfect. And neither are you. But don't let that imperfection stop you from being able to say, "Look, I'm going to get up because I know the God that I serve sees me not like I used to be, but like he envisions me to be." God looks at you and says, "Look, I see the purpose that I have for you. I see the best in you." No matter what age, no matter what time in your life, God is still working things out in your life. If you let him. The little things, praying, singing, just being present. You're gathered here today because God said, "Look, I wanted to make sure that you came and gathered around to hear from me that I love you unconditionally. I'm Almighty God, and I'm bold enough to give some of me to you so that you can be able to know that that love that I give you passes all understanding, and know that no matter where you go, I'm always there saying, 'Yes, you can do it. You can make a difference because I am there for you.'" Now with that, I want to wrap this up this way. I got some witnesses who made sure that they could give a testimony about the fact that God is able. Who do I hear from? Well, I hear from Moses. You know Moses? Moses, who by faith, he led the children of Israel past through the Red Sea on dry land. And when the Egyptians tried to come get him, guess what? They drowned. And then also I heard from a female matriarch, and that was a harlot called Rahab. Rahab didn't perish because she believed in the fact that the Israelites were the chosen ones. Rahab perished not with them that believed not, and she had received the spies with peace. And also I heard that we got a witness from a judge named Deborah. Yeah, there's some ladies in the Bible, like I said, too. A judge who judged Israel, and David also judged Israel. And basically, Deborah is one who says, "Yes, I'm a witness to the fact that God is a God who's able. Guess what? There's another one who's also able. I think y'all have heard of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in Daniel 3:17 said to the king, if it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. And how about Daniel? Remember Daniel? Daniel says God is able too, because Daniel was one who was challenged by being put in a lion's den. And the king, after he did that deed, he came near to the den where Daniel was, and he cried out in a tone of anguish. And the king declared to Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God whom you serve continually been able to deliver you from the lions? And you know the answer is yes, he was able to do that. And how about Mary, the mother of Jesus? Mary, the mother of Jesus, knows that God is able because she was blessed to be able to bear the Son of the Most High God. And how about Mary Magdalene? Mary Magdalene, who dared to come to Jesus, all the sin in the world didn't stop her from saying, look, I love you so much, I want to break my alabaster box of pure ointment and show you my love in a tangible way. And God blessed her for that. And how about Jesus himself? You know, Jesus knows God is able. Why? Because Jesus hung, bled, and died. And he gave his life for you and for me. And he trusted that God was going to be able to raise him up on the third day. And Jesus was raised. And we're testaments right now that God, through Jesus Christ, lives in us today. But I'm not going to stop there, because Jesus rose from the dead and he's living right now. But guess what? Jesus got some little Jesuses around here right now. And I spoke about it before. Little Mary Four Lines. I saw her the other day. She is a whippersnapper. She's got God all over her in her own way. Even the doctor had to smile when she said, look, doctor, I need to make sure that y'all do it right now, because if you don't, I'm going to be mad at you. I said, that sounds like Mary Four Lines. But Mary has a wonderful spirit. She took everything, all the instructions that the doctors gave her, in order. She took it in stride, and she did it with a smile on her face, because a merry heart does good like a medicine. And I was there to witness it. She said, Minister Long, I'm glad that you're here. And when I walked through the door, they all looked around and said, how does she know him? Well, that's the minister that was going to come to see me. So I went to see Mary. We took time to pray. Before I took time to pray, she made sure everybody else walked out the door. Then she called me alongside her so we could take time to pray. And so I prayed with Mary. Not just for her, but I prayed for the doctors, attending physicians, and all the care providers. And if you went to care for Mary, I prayed for you too, so that she would go through the surgery with peace that passes all understanding. And I'm telling you, she did. Matter of fact, I know she did, because I saw all the chain and lines of phone communications that went. I think y'all some kind of way synced me into it. Even somebody gave Mary's wrong phone number. and guess what? That was funny too. But we got the correct number to contact Mary, and Mary is really thriving well. She's going to be there for a little while, because there's a time and season for everything. There's a time for her to take time to heal and take time to mend, and she's doing it with the joy, because we will see Mary back in here dancing, listening, doing all those things that lets us know that our God we serve is a living and vital God. So, as I wrap this up, know that God is able. The God we serve is an all-powerful God. He's bold enough to let us have a portion of his power and his might. He loves us unconditionally, and God is everywhere. God is almighty, bold, loving, and everywhere. That's why the God we serve is an able God. Let us pray. God, I thank you for today. I thank you for your children who've come together to hear this word today. I thank you, Lord God, that we take it to heart, that we're called to serve you because you're an able God. You're an able God to those who believe you, to those who serve you, to those who come with a mind to give of their time, talent, and treasure. Because God, there ain't no way we can outgive you because you gave your best when you gave us your Son, Jesus the Christ. And we give thanks this day in Jesus' name. Amen. Our communion hymn is One Bread, One Body. Let's prepare for communion. Let's stand to our feet. Yes.
One Lord of all, one cup of blessing that we bless, and we, though many, throughout the earth, we are. Gentile or Jew, servant or free, woman or man, no more. One bread, one body, one Lord. One cup of blessing which we bless, and we, though many, throughout the earth, we are one body in this one. Many the gifts, many the works, one in the Lord of all, one bread, one body, one Lord of all. And we, though many, throughout the earth, we are one body in this one.
Thank you. I'm going to invite you to prayer for the elements.
Yeah, that's what I want.
One Lord of all, one cup of blessing that we bless, and we, one Lord.
you sing wonderfully, choir. You may be seated. You can be seated. Yeah, you can be seated. I'm going to invite you while you're seated for Julia to offer prayer for the bread and for the cup.
Our God, who is everywhere, our God of grace, you are our safe refuge from all we would fear. In Jesus Christ, who courageously faced the cross, you taught us that perfect love casts out fear. We delight in coming to your house filled with the beauty of your love to share at this table in the bread of life and the cup of life everlasting. Help us to realize that these symbols symbolize the coming of Jesus Christ into our midst, showing us the way of love and sacrifice. Teach us to follow Christ's example and to walk in meekness and humility. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Now, every Lord's Day, we come together as the Christian Church Disciples of Christ to celebrate this sacrament, the sacrament of communion. Now, today we have the elements here on the table, as well as for those who prefer, we have the elements that will be available for those cups and individual cups to be served as well. On the night our Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed, he took the bread, he blessed it, broke it, and said, "This is my body broken for you." And in like manner, Jesus took the cup and said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, which is my blood that's shed for the remission, the taking away of your sin. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show forth my death until I come again." See, this is God's divine medicine. Take the Lord's body, drink from the cup of the Lord, and receive it with all grace and all sufficiency at all times. In Jesus' name, amen. Which one would you like? Okay. You may come at this time. Body of our Lord Christ for you. Carl, the body of our Lord Christ for you. Body of our Lord Christ broken for you. All right. Body of our Lord Christ broken for you. Christ broken for you. All right. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ shed for you. Shame, the body of our Christ broken for you. Jack, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ for you. Mary, praise for you. A praise for you. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Blood of our Lord for Christ for you this summer. And the blood of our Lord for Christ for you, Carlson. Blood of our Lord Christ for you. Body of our Lord for Christ for you, Austin. Body of Christ for you, Ann. I cry, Lord Christ for you. Body of our Lord Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you, Christy. Body of Christ broken for you, Greg. Body of Christ shed for you. All right. Body of Christ for you, darling. All right, Sandy. Body of Christ for you, Aaron. Wait a minute. It makes a room. Body of Christ for you, Candy. Body of Christ for you, Davis. Thank you. Body of Christ for you, Carlton. Body of Christ for you, Gray. Let's go here. Body of Christ for you, Jennifer. Body of Christ for you. For you, Mitzi. I'll let you hold. Body of Christ for you. Go ahead.
How do you feel? Good. How do you feel?
Good.
All right, just checking. Our closing hymn is Trust and Obey, verses 1, 2, and 4. Let's all stand together and sing. Be happy in Jesus.
And in fellowship sweet, we will sit at his feet. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. I'm going to follow the light just like I hope you follow the light. Let that light of God shine wherever you go. Let's go out. And I do the benediction from back here. Thank you. May the love of God the Father, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and that sweet, sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with each and every one of us as we know that our God is able. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, bud. Excellent. Thank you. All right. Thank you. And thank you for lifting up your friend who we needed to pray for and everything. That was good.
Well, you're not as tired this week as you were last week.
That's true. That's true.